What do you make of the president's statement saying he is fully responsible for the bloody war on drugs?
Definitely he's the chief executive officer. No? He's the head of state and head of government. And therefore, yes, he is fully responsible for it. And that's precisely why, you know, the having been a member of the ICC, the Philippines has to comply and respect, you know, the ICC investigation.
And to show responsibility, are you satisfied with the DOJ?
Well, let's put it this way. More can be done, but we are thankful that they are finally looking into this. And we hope that they expand it precisely. Hindi lang 52 yan, mas marami pa. Kaya palagay ko, kinakailangan palawigin pa at talagang alamin. Dahil ang estima ay mga mahigit 30,000 na ang di umano'y pinatay at nanlaban. No? Of course, mas mababa yung datos ng PNP dahil iba yung mga riding in tandem na hindi police operation kuno. Pero nakita rin natin na yung mga nakamask, mayroong mga insidente na yung mga nakamask na di umano ay riding in tandem, ay mga police din pala.
Senator, let's talk about formally. I know that the Senate panel is already recommending charges against Michael Yang and other officers. Overview. Ano ang natuklasan sa formally deal after the president has repeatedly defended them?
Well, unang-una, yung ating mga batas sa procurement ay hindi sinunod. You know, violation of our procurement laws, even Bayanihan 1 and Bayanihan 2 laws. Giving anti-graft laws din in plunder cases kasi giving unwarranted benefits sa isang kumpanya that has caused injury to the government. The fact na 625,000 lang ang kanilang paid up capital, pero billion-billion ang nakuha nila. Meron din criminal negligence dahil halimbawa yung 550 million pesos worth of testing kits na nag-expire sa kanilang mga storage facilities habang kulang na kulang ang testing. Dito napakalaking injury sa government ang nangyari dito. Ginastos natin ng kalahating bilyon tapos kinapon lang natin dahil nag-expire na yung mga testing kits. Dahil nga hindi up to standards yung expiration requirement. No? Nariyan din yung hindi pagbayad ng mga taxes, tax evasion, mga kumpanyang foreign na showing that they are above the law, Philippine laws, by refusing or failing to pay taxes sa mga transaction nila. Ni wala nang permit to operate at wala nang business permit. Eh talagang marami ang kasalanan na natuklasan dito. Kitang-kita, naglabas ng listahan si Senator Ping Lacson ng mga nag-import. Pati nga yung produkto, yung mask, in-import. Iba-ibang kumpanya, iba-ibang pangalan. Tapos, sila ang nag-import, binenta sa lokal, binenta naman ng lokal sa DBMPS. Eh kung ang DBMPS ay talagang masusing nagbabantay, dapat kinausap na lang nila yung BOC. O sino yung mga nag-i-import ng mga mask para makausap na naming diretso? So clearly there was a conspiracy to defraud government of billions of pesos worth of COVID funds. Napakalungkot dahil na habang namamatay, nagkakasakit, at walang maliwanag o sustained na support sa ating frontliners, ito ang nangyayari. COVID ang problema, hindi Lamborghini tsaka Porsche ang solusyon.
And Senator, has it been made clear in the hearings, it's been established formally was favored? Was it really favored?
Well, to my mind, they could not answer the fact that there was this company in Bataan, the processing zone, MedTech, that could produce up to 2 million masks, you know, a month. And yet, in February, they did not accommodate MedTechs and went to Farmally, which, as was shown, was not didn't have the capital, enough capital, and was just borrowing money from Michael Young. Inuna yung mga foreigners, yung imported na mga produkto kesa sa yung lokal. About 25,000 jobs were lost because the local companies that could manufacture this and are already manufacturing these masks were not given the opportunity. So clearly, Farmally was favored over and above. Hindi nga siya manufacturing firm. Trading firm lang siya. And clearly also, there is this other company, Philippine United Tech, yung PUTC company. Again, Michael Young, Phil Wynn, involved in the BGI testing kits that were purchased at 2.6 billion. Pati yun, overpriced. Dahil 1,700 pesos ang halaga, when in fact 750 to 900 ang bili ng Red Cross sa mga nasabing mga testing kits. So it's really all the all the pieces of evidence for massive, di ba, massive corruption in the billions are all there already.
Senator, Health Secretary Francisco Duque says the DOH had nothing to do with the DBM choosing the supplier. He didn't even sign the contracts. Is the DOH not liable for any of the contracts closed with Farmally?
No, the original sin was the transfer of 42 billion pesos worth of DOH funds to the DBMPS.
But he says the COA cleared him.
Well, the COA cleared him, and the COA itself has said. No, the COA itself has said that they are now beginning to look into a special audit, and they're actually doing a special audit. So the findings last July are not final. So let's wait for the special audit, because they're saying they are conducting a special audit. Now, hopefully, lalabas before the end of the year.
Mm-mm. Who would be behind Undersecretary Christopher Lau for him to have this kind of brazenness in closing these contracts?
Well, the report, the preliminary report, and I agree with it, it says that there is the imprimatur of Malacañang. No? So, hindi naman maaaring mangyari yan. No? Na, at kung hindi man, di ba, sabihin natin initially involved, eventually involved dahil pinoprotektahan at talagang inuuna nga ang pagbanat sa COA, pag-atake sa senador, sa mga senador, sa halip na atakihin at imbestigahan yung mga nangungurakot at yung mga gumawa ng pang-aabuso sa pondo ng COVID.
Are you seeing a connection with the DOH and the DBM in terms of the 9 billion peso deal? Kumbaga, ang tawag nila sindikato?
Well, posible, no? Eh, hindi naman pwedeng mangyari ito na this cannot happen without the connivance or at least the criminal neglect, di ba, of those involved. You know, yun na lang simpleng, why are they basing the purchases of these bulk sales sa retail prices? That's very basic. Anyone who has a business, retail business knows, iba ang wholesale price sa retail price. That's so basic. And Secretary Duque himself said that the SRP is retail. When they issued that memo, It's for retail prices, meaning it's to protect the consumer. In this case, they use the retail prices as basis to buy millions of face masks in bulk. And that in itself, when he admitted that mali, overpriced, itong mga face masks na binili at 22 or 27 pesos. In fact, the retail nga, ang sinasabi nila, yung wholesale would be around 13 pesos. So you can imagine, almost double ang overpriced. And then, walang tax records. Ayaw isubmit ng formally yung kanilang tax records. Nagbayad ba ng tax? Hindi ba? O hindi? Magkano yung kanilang cost of sales? Wala. They refuse to submit it. It's the hearings have been going on since August. It's already October. And they have not turned over the documents, which will prove and show how much they bought it, how much they sold it, because that's precisely what the audited financial statements should include among supporting documents.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, Senator, with a partial report of the Senate panel, what are you seeing in terms of the officers of Farmally? Lincoln Ong is still detained at Pasay City Jail. Is that correct?
No. He's, if I'm not mistaken, he's still in the Senate.
Okay, so there was no transfer, because what I've read so far is there's a transfer.
The last hearing or the previous hearing to the last one is that Senator Gordon said, although we had wanted him transferred to the Pasay City Jail, that he reconsidered, considering the possible threat to the life of Lincoln Ong. So my understanding is he's still in the Senate.
Okay. Now, taking on the other side, since this is in aid of legislation, Malacanang says the Senate has been abusing its contempt powers.
Our contempt powers is based on our rules and based on jurisprudence. And if I may say, this is not just in aid of legislation. We also have oversight powers. Oversight meaning we want to know how funds are being spent and why they're being spent the way they're being spent because of our oversight powers. It's not just for purposes of legislation. Although, yes, this is in aid of legislation, but among the other powers of Congress is oversight. And that's what we're exercising here, because how can we craft a new budget, for example, and approve a new budget for the DOH if precisely there are gaps in their execution and there is, you know, leakage and there is massive corruption.
Mm-mm. What changes will be made after the hearing? Like, number one, will the PSDBM still remain? The other agency is PTIC. Two agencies where funds are parked.
Well, right now, we are crafting the general appropriations measure for 2022. And the discussions in the Senate Committee on Finance is that we may have to provide specific provisions on prohibiting such transfers that have been practiced in the past. So that is one concrete result of our hearings in terms of putting more safeguards so that public funds are not abused in such a manner. Yung ililipat tapos nakapark dun. So may mga provisions, for example, na ibabalik, di ba? Regardless, babalik dapat ang pondo ng budget ng isang departamento kung hindi niya nagasta. Hindi pwedeng nakapark sa PITC o kaya sa DBMPS. Of course, meron ding legislation, minumungkahi, i-abolish na itong PITC at yung DBMPS. Kasi lahat naman ng mga ahensya ng pamahalaan may sarili niyang bids and awards committee. Yun nga rin ang isang naging problema. Kaya dapat DOH at hindi DBMPS ang gumawa nito dahil mga medical equipment ito. Kinakailangan ng expertise yung mga testing kit. Siguro kung ang DBMPS, siguro kung ang DOH ang gumawa nito, yung pag-purchase, alam nila na dapat sabay yung extraction kits ng testing kits at yung testing kit mismo, at hindi unahin yung testing kit tapos sumunod ng tatlong buwan yung extraction. Ibig sabihin, yung testing, kung alam mo yung technology, sasabihin mo dapat sabay. Kasi walang saysay yung testing kit kung wala yung extraction kit. At yun ang naging reklamo ng napakaraming LGU. Natanggap nila yung testing kit, walang extraction kit. Eh kung alam nung, sino ba? Wala namang medical technologist na expert itong DBMPS. So talagang dahil sa kakulangan ng kapasidad and expertise, ayan. Tapos yung 6 months, sabi nung DOH, 6 months daw, pwede nang yung shelf life. When in fact, sabi nila dapat 24 to 36 months, hindi nag-e-expire. Pero tinanggap nila 2 months na lang, mag-e-expire na. Dahil DBMPS ang nag-purchase nito, hindi siguro naisip yung mga ibang mga bagay. Ayun, kalating bilyon tinapon dahil nga nag-expire sa loob ng storage.
But Senator, what happens to Christopher Lau? The president has transferred him. I mean, clearly transferred or at least taken him out of DBM. There's another acting head right now.
Well, I think that's part of the that's part of the effort to conceal, no? Yung conveniently after the act has been consummated, get away, di ba? And move on, no? So parang may pattern din dun, no? He had a case before the HUDC on extortion, may reklamong inihain sa kanya nung siya ay executive director dun. Umalis siya. Tapos mamaya DBM undersecretary na. Tapos nung nagkaroon na ng umalis na naman, no? So well, he can run, he can hide, but he will have to answer for all this, you know. Hindi lahat ng taon sila yung nakaupo, ika nga.
Let's move now to your vice presidential bid. You told Christian Esguerra that you were willing to slide down if there was a more winnable or viable candidate for Vice President Lenny Robredo. Is it still the same as of today?
Well, we discussed this with the Vice President, and you know, we did not expect yung bumabaha ang suporta. No? Talagang ang ating mga kababayan ay, sabi ko nga eh, kung nakakahawa yung takot, nakakahawa din yung tapang. No? So nakita nila siguro na yung Senado ay tinututulan itong formally at yung corruption ng Malacañang. Tapos nagtumaya si Vice President Lenny at sabi niyang lalaban siya. Eh palagay ko nahawa na yung ating mga kababayan dun sa tapang na ipinamalas ng mga senador, si Senator Gordon. Of course, na hindi tayo nagpapatinag kahit tayo ay binabato ng batikos. Tapos si parang things fell into place. So wala na, no? Wala nang atrasa nito. Sabi ko nga eh, the first 3 days, I was trying to figure out, di ba? Ako ba eh sinagasaan ng 6x6 o ng dump truck, no? But after a while, na-realize ko ang sumasagasa pala sa akin eh yung ating mga kababayan na talagang tumatayo na at tumitindig. This motorcades, for example, in the coming days, this is purely spontaneous. Wala kaming inorganisa dito. Merong inorganisa ang mga volunteers sa Bicol last week. And then I think meron din sa Cebu. Tapos, it exploded. You know, so the explosion, yung bumabaha ang suporta, talagang yan ang nag-uudyok sa atin. Kaya tuloy-tuloy na ito, wala nang atrasa.
But this is a big risk for you, Senator, because you would have been a shoe-in for the Senate.
Well, you know, sabi ko nga, we're doing this for our children. So, and as a mother, you will do anything to protect your children and provide for them. And this is what we're doing. So, yes, it's a risk. But, you know, we're willing to take this risk because I think our children deserve a better future.
Okay. And what about feedback from experts saying with you running, Senate President Tito Soto and Senator Bongo, is you are both giving a chance, a bigger chance for Senator Bongo to actually win? You have to remember that Senate President Tito Soto was 10 points ahead.
Yes, yes. Well, you know, we have different constituencies. I have been championing farmers and fisher folk advocacies for over a decade now. And therefore, I think rural ang ating isa sa mga constituencies natin. So, and I think in the end, talagang marami pang mangyayari, no, in terms of voter preference, no? So yung mga polling ngayon, malamang ibang-iba yan pagdating ng dulo. So we will campaign as best as we can. We will do our best. And the rest, we will leave to the God Almighty. And of course, our voters. So I disagree that this might give the administration a greater chance. We will see. No, let's wait. Sabi nga nila, yung sure winner na sa September of this, you know, of any election, in the last three presidential elections, yung sure winner nung September, talo. No? So marami pang mangyayari. So these numbers and the, it's too early, no? To conclude one way or the other.
But is the vice president setting aside that one Senate seat in her slate for you?
No. We are in discussions already. And I think that one slot will be filled up soon. No? Nag-uusap pa. Pero pina-finalize na yan. And then there will be an announcement pretty soon.
Mm-mm. So what about talks with Senator Manny Pacquiao for a unification ticket?
Wala na yung, well, after precisely when the talks bogged down, and this is what the vice president also said, tapos na, no? Tapos na yung unity talks. We now focus on winning it in May.
Mm-hmm. The latest survey shows that former Senator Bongbong Marcos is number one. The possibility of a Marcos going back into Malacañang?
Well, that's always a possibility, given we know how much resources they have at their disposal, and you can already see it. But like I said, in 2004, the front runner was Rocco, Raul Rocco, about 10 months into the elections. In 2010, the front runner was Manny Villar, 10 months before the elections. In 2016, it was Grace Poe who was the front runner, 10 months before elections. So all the front runners ended up unable to sustain their leads in the polls. So he's ahead now, but the poll that really matters is on May 9, 2022.
Anong reaction ninyo? I'm sure you've seen this text and you've heard comments. This supposed Lenny movement ay pangmayaman lang daw.
Hindi siguro.
I'm sure you've heard that.
Yes. Well, I guess some are concerned.
Hindi daw ito totoong movement.
Some are concerned and we respect that. But once local officials start supporting VP Lenny, and there have been quite a number already, that's not just pang elite. The local officials are the most sensitive to the public pulse. So we have Mayor Jerry Trenas of Iloilo, Mayor Roca Moreno of Cagayan de Oro in Mindanao. So for those who are concerned, we understand you want us to win, and therefore we really have to broaden and reach out because really, your concern is something that we are factoring in terms of being able to move away from our echo chambers. But we also say when local officials start, diba, considering supporting Vice President Lenny's bid, that groundswell or that yung bumabaha ng suporta is not just among the elite. Because the local officials are the first to feel the public pulse, yung lokal. At pagka sila'y sumusuporta na kay VP Lenny, ang ibig sabihin nun, nararamdaman nila. Yung, sabi ko nga eh, dati iilan lang kami, yung mga tumitindig at tumututol sa hindi tamang makapalakad. In the last 5 years, we were bashed, we were trolled. My daughter was threatened with death or rape. Sharon was also, but you know, we stuck to what we believed in. I did not give up. You know, I could have just said, tama na, hindi ko na kaya ito. But sabi ko, I'm doing this for my children. And today, with all the outpouring of support, yung bumabahangan ng suporta, eh, talagang hindi na kami nag-iisa, hindi na kami kukuunti. Unti-unti nang dumadami at lumalawak ang suporta at tiwala para sa at tumitindig. And that really is encouraging us and inspiring us to fight till the very end.
Senator, I'm curious, has Sharon spoken with Tito Sen?
They were communicating, you know. I also spoke, as I said. Yeah. But they were in communication.
You spoke with Tito Sen, and what did he say?
Well, I called him the day before the announcement, and I informed him that first, I thanked him for taking my call, and that I said it was best. I felt it best to tell him personally, you know, over the phone that. The plans had changed, no? And it was unexpected, but I felt that VP Lenny had to be supported in this announcement and also in ensuring that there is a tandem, that she is a vice presidential candidate. So we left it at that. Ang sabi nga, ganyan talaga, nangyayari yan. So, of course, sabi ko nga, masakit sa atin. Masakit for Sharon, but like you, I suppose, your family, you also have your share of conflicts, differences, minsan nagiging masakit or emotional, but we pray, we hope that after all is said and done, that for the hurt that this has caused, we seek, we hope for reconciliation and forgiveness, no? For the pain caused, no? So Sharon, yeah, and we prayed about it with Sharon, and she said, "Nga, wherever I am, she will support," and that's what she's been doing also. And she, nauna pa nga siyang nanawagan na tumakbo si VP Lenny publicly. She threw her support over a year ago, I think. No? So there, yeah.
Well, I'm curious, you talked about the pain caused. Does this mean that your talk with Senate President Tito Soto didn't end well?
No. It ended in a, you know, wala, hindi kami nag-away, wala, walang ganun.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Pero maliwanag, you know, that Sharon, of course, siyempre, lahat nga ng pamilya pagka nagkaroon ng ganung rift, di ba? Masakit siya, di ba?
Before we go to a quick break, there are also critics questioning how could Senator Trillanes and former Vice President Jojo Binay both be in the slate?
Oh, well, you know, I've said this before. We have to set aside our differences if we are to unite behind who we believe to be the one who will help solve COVID and bring our country back and resuscitate the economy, no? And I believe that would be Vice President Lenny. Sabi ko nga, nung panahon ng EDSA 1, no, People Power, si Fidel Ramos tsaka si Johnny Enrile naroon sa Camp Aguinaldo. Nung February 22, sabi ni Cardinal Sin, at ni Butch Aquino was the younger brother of Ninoy, who was assassinated, di ba? They both said, go to EDSA and support Enrile and Ramos. You know, if they said, teka muna, si Enrile at si Ramos yan, huwag kayong pumunta dyan dahil sila ang architect ng martial law, eh baka wala yung EDSA people power. Diba?
But then,
in other words, yes, we have differences, you know, but I think the bigger challenge really is COVID. Yun talaga ang kaaway natin. And unless we defeat COVID, you know, the economy will never recover. And that's precisely why the priority, ang tunay na kalaban natin sa ngayon ay ang COVID. At naniniwala tayo, ang solusyon ay yung pamumuno na ipinakita na at pinapakita pa rin ni Vice President Lenny.
Just going back to the Senate slate, but that's why people can't understand. If you have Senator Trillanes and Jojo Binay together, why won't Nericol Menares be in the slate?
Well, that's what we're working on now, no? Because...
Okay. Will he be the last? Will he be the last person?
Well, there are discussions. Okay. This is being finalized. We are also in discussions with Isambayan, because Isambayan is also putting together a slate. So we will see how that turns out. And, we are hopeful that in the end, we can set aside our differences, unite behind Vice President Lenny's candidacy so that we can finally fix what's broken dito sa government response sa COVID. And of course, yung problema ng gutom. If I may say, hunger has been exacerbated and affects millions of our kababayans because of the economic near collapse of the economy. Naghihingalo na ang ating ekonomiya. Mm-hmm. And as former food security secretary and an advocate for food security, I guess that will be, I believe that will be part of our contribution to address the challenges both of COVID, hunger, and unemployment.
Before we talk about, we'll talk about the budget and COVID after the break, but are you confirming that Nericol Menares might be that last candidate?
Let's just wait for the announcement. There are discussions that are being undertaken, and we're looking at a possible win-win. So, hintayin na lang natin.